If you want to talk now about the epidemiology and the costs of disorders of sleepfulness and wakefulness, you begin to ask your question, why do you have to sleep? Why do you have to do that? It seems like you're wasting a third of your life. Not really. Not at all, actually. The purpose of sleep could be to actually maintain your garden. You know, if your garden is full of trees and branches, you are maybe changing your synapse formation and your synapse revisions at night. Did you ever hear the term, I'd like to sleep on that? Interesting. And maybe that's what's happening. You can make a decision because, you know, some neurotransmission is occurring at night to change your connections. And of course, the other thing is that it appears that if you do not have sleep after you learn something, that the consolidation of that memory is far weaker. And so I don't know if you've ever pulled an all-nighter, you know, and gone and taken a test, aced it, and then you couldn't take the test again because you didn't sleep at all, you just studied all night. Maybe there's something to this. But we think that also the purpose of sleep is to prevent you from having psychiatric disorders. And it will show you what happens if you don't sleep and you have insomnia, how much psychiatric disorder you get over time. That's the cost of a sleep disorder, a psychiatric disorder. You can also mess up your immunity. Your immunity is not right. Remember we talked in some of the lectures, and particularly the one on mood lecture, about immunity and neuroinflammation? Well, you can trigger problems with neuroinflammation by not sleeping enough. It's involved with neurological disorders, especially pain. You know, if you have pain, you don't get delta slow wave sleep, and then you don't get restorative, and you wake up and the pain bothers you. If you can get good sleep, the pain bothers you less. There's economic costs, sickness, absence, low productivity, car accidents, not driving well. There's endocrine dysfunction. Cancer is enhanced if you don't sleep. And so are cardiometabolic disorders like diabetes, heart disease, heart attacks, and stroke. So sleep's not trivial. A lot of people say, I sleep when I'm dead. That's a famous saying. But the reality is, you don't sleep, you will be dead maybe, or you'll have a problem. So sleep is a real important thing to invest in. It's involved with cognition. For example, if you have a sleep-wake cycle disturbance, you can impair the neurogenesis, because actually in your hippocampus you can make new neurons. That's called neurogenesis, as opposed to making new connections, which is synaptogenesis. The brain needs to make, restore its nerves and its connections. And it does a lot of that work when you're sleeping. And if you don't do it, you get a cognitive dysfunction. Guess what? If you impair your sleep-wake cycle, you're more likely to decrease your leptin, increase your ghrelin, and change your microbiota, and in doing that, gain weight. So if you gain weight, that has knock-on effects beyond obesity to medical illness such as diabetes and cardiovascular disease. What are the other conditions associated with insomnia? Numerous medical conditions, substance abuse, psychiatric conditions, behavioral and psychological issues. Medications can both make you sleep and not let you sleep, and sleep-wake disorders. We will talk about some of the more sleep-wake disorders in another lecture. We have tried to touch on the comorbidity or the, you know, contribution of insomnia to these other conditions in the relevant chapters as well. Here I'm just going to mention that insomnia is related to psychiatric illness in a very profound way. And in fact, insomnia is one of the best signals that you aren't well yet. Some people even call it a psychiatric vital sign. So if you will, one of the things to monitor in a patient as you're treating them is if their insomnia goes away. Because that may be one of the last things to get better and to go into remission. The other thing is to monitor when their insomnia comes back, because that could be a sign of a relapse. So treating patients to the point of getting all their symptoms gone except insomnia and then quitting is not a good approach. Because 3 to 5 years of insomnia, let's say they had depression, they had anxiety, guess what they're going to do in 3 to 5 years for sure? They're going to be 2 times more likely to relapse into an anxiety or to develop their first one. 4 times more likely to develop depression or develop their first episode, and 7 times more likely to develop substance use disorders. So insomnia is not trivial. There's some questions about insomnia because the diagnostic things change over the years. Sometimes insomnia is a freestanding illness on its own. Sometimes it's a symptom. Where I stand, I take a symptom list, and this is a symptom I'm trying to get rid of. And I'm not seeing people that just have this symptom unless they're between episodes. Generally speaking, this accompanies these other psychiatric conditions.